Let's begin our song service this morning by turning to number 284. Got a request for this one, 284, first and last verse. On our prayer request list this morning, we've been asked to remember Steve Chaney, Bobby Cromer, Gary Scott, Bonnie Kirby, Robert Heisel, Gene Harrison, Donnie McFerrin, Joyce Howe, Liza Argenbite, Pat Rader, Kim Hickey, Charles Bowman, Logan Mullins, Lena Smith, Ron Argenbright, James and Peachy Boone, Juanita and Coleman Dethridge, Joyce McComb, Gene Botkins, David Overbay, Fred McClure, Billy Haddocks, Betty Sizemore, Baby Sailor, Jamie Sailor, Shirley Mullins, Dr. Larkey, Maddie Wheat, Jeannie West, and the family of Frida Doan, the family of Bill Cromer, and the family of Gary Behrens. So let's remember those in our prayers. So let's move this one right along. It's a fast song, and we'll leave that coda out on the last verse. 284.
I've been traveling in this life with its heartaches, troubles, and strife. Sometimes Satan tries to tell me to turn aside. I say, Satan, get thee behind. No returning in me you'll find. I've been near my heavenly home where
Yeah.
last verse of this one.
"'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the saved the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove
this morning will come from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. It certainly is wonderful to see everyone here this morning. Looks like we got a few out. Let's be sure to pray for them that they will get to feeling better and their health will be good enough to be back with us and worship very soon. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Without any mistakes on my part, that was the reading of John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. We now have a great honor and privilege to go to the Heavenly Father in a word of prayer. Yeah.
first to last verse of number 136.
Some glad morning we shall see Jesus in the air, coming after you and me, joy is ours to share. What rejoicing there will be when the saints shall rise, headed for that jubilee yonder in the skies. Oh, what singing,
singing,
oh, what shouting,
shouting,
on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory,
glory,
hallelujah,
glory,
when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies. When with all that heavenly host we begin to sing, singing in the Holy Ghost, how the heavens will ring. Millions there will join the song, with them we shall be, praising Christ through ages long, heaven's jubilee. Oh, what singing,
singing,
oh, what shouting,
shouting,
on that happy morning when we all shall rise. Oh, what glory,
glory,
hallelujah,
glory,
when we meet our blessed Savior in the skies.
Our invitation hymn will be number 600, the hardback hymn number 600. Turn to that and hold that for the time of the invitation in a few minutes. Certainly want to welcome everyone that's come out this first day of the week, beautiful Lord's Day. We do have several out that are sick this morning, so we want to, of course, continue to remember them in the prayers. Spend a few minutes talking about God's Word. A few weeks ago, we talked about God's promises and learned of what He's promised us throughout the Bible and what we have to do, what's required to be a child of God. And of course, that's one of the most important things we can plan for in this life, this short life here on earth. is plan and be ready for Christ's second coming or when our lives are required of us. So God's Word is so important to our lives. And it's a roadmap that we're to follow. And it's God's inspired instruction, speaking directly to us through inspired men of God, that we can follow and know assuredly of its truth and of course where it comes from and the authority. We see in the Gospel of John here that we know of God's Word from the very beginning. The very first verse says, "The beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and darkness comprehended it not." So we know from the very beginning of God's authority, just from His spoken word, He created the universe, the world. You know, He created in the Garden of Eden everything that Adam and Eve needed.
by his spoken word, he made man out of the dust of the ground and created woman out of his side as a helpmate. We know they were given everything they needed in the garden, but what happened? They disobeyed God. So they were driven from the garden, and this curse of sin has pervaded our lives all throughout the centuries from that time. But God's word, we know, has remained. We can look all throughout the Old Testament. We can see the Old Testament of the histories and of the laws and of the prophets, of the kings. We're told that this is given to us for a learning. You know, we can look back at history. We can see the mistakes of others, and we can learn from those mistakes. We know we're not supposed to make those same mistakes over and over again. So God's word is given to us. It's his holy word that we're to study. And it doesn't matter how old we are, we can all continue to grow spiritually as we read and as we study God's word. So we see that from the very beginning, the Word was God, the Word was with God, and Christ, too, is the Word. He was with God from the very beginning. And then on down in verse 12, he explains, you know, why the Word is so important to us today and has been all throughout the eras of history. He says in verse 12, as many as received him, to them gave he power to become sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So it's only through God and God's word that we learn of the second covenant, which we're under now, which we're going to be judged. We learn from the New Testament. We learn from these Gospels of Christ's life and his words that he's left for us. We learn of the plan of salvation, the roadmap that we are to follow, the examples that are given, the patterns that are given for us that we are to obey his commands if we expect to become sons of God and thus able to inherit eternal life. We know this life on earth is brief, and we are to prepare all of our lives for this battle. We see over in Peter. Let's look for just a minute at 1 Peter, the first chapter. We see there beginning let's back up to verse 22. 1 Peter 1:22, Peter writes, seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart, fervently, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. He says here, God's word is going to abide forever. Things, fads, people come and go, but God's word abides forever, and it will abide forever till the end of time. This same scale by which we will be judged on the day of judgment is not changing. It's not changing based on fashion, on what's popular today, but his word, his truth is the same. And never wavereth. We're not to add to or take from God's word. It is constant. It abideth forever and ever. All flesh is as grass. Verse 24. We know our lives of flesh and blood are very temporary. It's here today and gone tomorrow. All flesh is as grass. And all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. And the grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But, he James makes a summary here in the last verse. But, listen closely, he's saying, but the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word by which the gospel is preached unto you. So this word, we know of God's word, abideth forever and ever, and it will abide. It will be there throughout all of our lives and our children's lives and our grandchildren's lives, the generations that come after us until the end of time, until Christ comes again. So we see the importance of God's word, and I think many times we fail to understand or we fail to realize the importance of God's word. We get busy in our everyday life. The Bible sits on the table or the stand, and we never pick it up except when we come to church. Look at it a few minutes. You know, as Christians, we're to read, we're to study, not just listen to man and agree with everything, but we've got to read and be sure what we're being told is truth, and what we're being told, what we hear, what we obey, truly does come from the Bible, from God's word. You know, we hear all kinds of man's opinion and what man thinks. Many will say, well, I know the Bible says that, but I believe baptism's not necessary. You know, we know if we read the Bible, we can see the plan of salvation where we're told that baptism is necessary. All of the steps of salvation are necessary. We can't leave any out. We're to obey His word to the letter. So we know of the great importance of the Bible because of where it comes from. From God Himself, all power, all authority, forever and ever. And the word, you know, if we look word up in the dictionary, it'll say something like an expression or a remark or a promise, news or a command. But, you know, we're familiar with words that are spoken and the importance of them. And this is God's word directly through Christ and through inspired men of God speaking to us. He don't appear to us today as He appeared to the prophets, you know, and led them and told them what to believe. But it's through Christ and His great love for us, through God's love, even after we disobeyed Him, even after we sinned, it's His love for us. John 3:16, He so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son. His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. And He willingly left the joys of heaven and came into this world of sin and of sorrow. Gave His life, you know, we're very familiar, an agonizing death on the cross of Calvary for you and for me. It's through His love that He offers this gift. Paul told the Romans, you know, 6:23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Through Christ's suffering on the cross, He enabled us to have eternal life as the sons of God. If we obey, conditions, there's requirements. We have to obey His will. We see Paul explaining a lot of these concepts and these words to help us understand the importance of God's word as he wrote to the Hebrews. We find in Hebrews the 4th chapter, there he talks about the importance, and he gives a great description of God's word and its importance in our life. He says in verse 12, Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is quick. It's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that's not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. God knows all about us, not only all we say and all we do, but all we think. It says even the hairs of our head are numbered. There's nothing we keep secret from him. He knows all. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that's passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. So this Christ, Jesus, the Son of God, he left the joys of heaven. He took on flesh and bone and blood just like us. He was tempted of Satan, you know, just as we are tempted. Taken on to the high mountain, promised all of this notoriety by Satan. What was Christ's response? Each case, for it is written. He goes back to God's word and shows why he can't yield to that temptation. He was in all manners tempted like as we are, yet without sin, the only one perfect that lived here on earth. So verse 16, he kindly sums up this chapter. He says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So this is very important here. We learn of the importance of God's word and the importance that we should place in our everyday life. The word of God is quick, he said. And it's by the word of God that we know his authority. God who created heaven and earth. We know of his authority and his power. All authority and all power. And we know that he was from the beginning, and all that's said and done, he knows about us. People sometimes say, you know, the Bible is out of date. It's for old times. You know, we're even told there's going to be lots of false teachers in the last days that will try to drive us away from God's word and from God's will and God's command. But we are to be weary of false teachers and know the truth, and the truth will lead us. So the Bible is so powerful, and it's so powerful, you know, it convinces sinners, once they hear and believe, to turn. And we know of its power. We know of its power all through the New Testament as Christ selected his apostles, the disciples who would later have the Great Commission to carry this word forward into all of the world. We know that his word was powerful enough to raise the dead, as we see of Lazarus, that not only died but had been in the grave several days, and his word brought forth Lazarus. So we know of its great power. We know of its power to make the deaf to hear. We know of its power to make the blind to see, and the dumb to speak, and the lame to walk. It's powerful enough to overcome Satan's many temptations that tries to lead us astray. It's powerful enough to ensure us and encourage us, just have been studying from the book of Revelation, we know while John was there on the Isle of Patmos, he wrote Revelation to encourage Christians that were persecuted during that time, and to encourage us, give us an insight into the future. We know what's going to happen at the end of time. We know the fate of Satan and his angels. We know the fate of those who walk with Satan and are of the world and do not pay attention to God's word. We know they're going to be defeated. We know they're going to be cast into the bottomless pit. We know that this battle, who's going to win the war? Satan may win a battle of souls, and we're told many are going to fall aside, are going to fall off of the straight and narrow path, be lost, have no hope of eternal life in our heavenly home. But we know that in the end, death has no sting over the Christian, over the faithful who have remained faithful, who have prepared, who have read, who have studied, who have followed God's word and made it important in their daily lives. So this is his encouragement to us today. We know of its importance. We know of its power. He says, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. So again, he gives here a symbol of this sword that's sharp on both sides. We know of the God's word is powerful as it's compared to a sword here, cutting, sharp. And this was, you know, used in battle of causing great damage as people were pierced with a sword and this huge cut resulted. So it's sharper, he's saying here, sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing asunder the soul and spirit. So the word of God can separate us, can cut us off from the world, can cut us off from sin. It can bring us back. That's the power of God's word. No matter how evil, how much of the world we may have been earlier, we remember the example of Paul as he was Saul. He had warrants of arrest, you know, from the powers that be, the Jews, to arrest. He persecuted, he threw in prison Christians just for proclaiming to be a Christian. But the sword, the word of God is powerful as he appeared to Saul and he heard the word. It was powerful enough for him to believe and change his life. He left that world that he thought was right, turned to the Lord, and was more determined than ever. Since his earlier life had been spent in unrighteousness and in sin, you know, he was more determined than ever. He was going to make it right. He was going to do all he could for the Lord and spent the rest of his life proclaiming the gospel and traveling and setting up these New Testament churches and doing all he could to win souls for Christ. So we can look at his example. We see the power of the word, of the sword that pierces even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirits and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So it's powerful enough to pierce even to the joints and marrow, the inside, the parts that are hid from the outside, things that maybe we think are secret, that are unknown, sins that have been committed, laws that have been broken, that someone thinks they've gotten by with. God knows all. He knows not only all you've done and said, He knows of the thoughts of your heart and mind. So the Word is powerful enough to cut asunder those secret inner thoughts of the mind. It's strong enough to bring you back to Christ, to learn and obey the plan of salvation, to be an obedient Christian, and thus able to become a child of God and to leave the world of unbelief and follow God's Word and do our best to our ability to stay on that straight and narrow path that leads to life everlasting. And he says it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So what's he talking about here in this last part of the verse? Discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Well, to discern is able to make a difference, or old enough to understand, know the difference in good and evil, to know the difference between right and wrong. And once we reach the age of accountability, you know, where we know the difference in right and wrong, we understand the plan of salvation, we understand what God wants us to do, you know, we're responsible. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Once we mature enough and we're old enough to understand God's Word and understand the importance of God's Word, you know, we're responsible. We're responsible for our actions. So we find that God's Word will be able to help the unbeliever to see the error of his way and to look at their heart and know what is first in their lives and what's important. If it's the world, the lust of the things in the world, money, the goods, the material things, or is it the Word of God and God's Word to lead us into righteousness? So it's the Word of God. God's Word is strong enough to bring those from a world of sin and bring them to Christ and obey the plan of salvation. This is why God's Word is most important in our lives, and we should all pay more attention to it. We know, of course, again, of its very importance. Just because, as we saw in John 1:1, the Word was God and the Word was with God. So we know of its source that has been left to us through Jesus Christ and through the disciples. We find that Paul, as he wrote to Timothy, he told Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:16, he says, all scriptures, talking about the Word, God's Word, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So this is the power of God's Word. This is all it can do as we read and study and as we accept it. It's profitable, or it's good. It's important for the doctrine, how we should conduct ourselves, how we should worship upon the first day of the week, for reproof, for showing error of your way, error of worship, how we are to be pleasing unto the Lord, for correction, changing from our error and following God's Word exactly as it's laid out. And for instruction in righteousness, how to live daily our Christian lives. So this is the inspiration of the Word that's given to mankind. And he ends by saying that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So he's not saying we can achieve perfection. None of us will be perfect, you know, like Christ was here on earth. But we can strive for that perfection by trying daily, striving to follow God's word to the letter, and how we interact with others and how we speak to others. So this is the importance of God's word and the importance in our daily life. We see that God's word from these gospels, we see the harmony of the gospels as Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all wrote of Christ's life and how he was born, the divine birth, and how he chose his disciples. You know, his disciples didn't come from the hierarchy of the Sanhedrin or great religious leaders of that time. The disciples all come from common tasks, common jobs. We see fishermen, others, Matthew, tax collector. But we see this great commission Christ gave to them. You know, it was these disciples that he gave the great commission to go into all the world and preach the gospel. You know, they couldn't do that on their own. They didn't know all of God's word. But Christ said, I'll give you all you need. I'll be with you. Second chapter of Acts. You know, after Christ had fulfilled his mission, he had he arose from the dead. Peter preached that first gospel sermon. They were given the gift of the Holy Ghost. And Christ gave them this commission. And he said, you know, don't think of what you're going to say. I will help you. I will tell you. As they went to the synagogues and taught, the religious leaders of the day were marveled. They couldn't believe these men had so much knowledge. They had never been to the great universities or the great teachers of the day, but they knew all of the Bible, the prophets. They knew Christ's words. God gave them. They were inspired by God, God's word through them that we could have as our roadmap. And they, of course, led many to Christ. They spread that word, that inspired word, all over the known world at that time to the Samaritans that had never heard this word, and on to the Gentiles. First taught to the Jews and then, of course, the Gentiles. As Revelations says, whosoever will. God's word is not meant, it's not directed just at one nation. It's not directed just at one race or one group of people. It's directed to all. Whosoever will excludes nobody. God's word is for all of us. And all has the same gift of eternal life. But we have to reach out. We've got to accept that gift. We've got to put it to use in our daily lives. We've got to hear it, or we've got to read it. We've got to believe it and accept it, or be determined we're going to change. All have sinned. Earn is death. Wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. We hear, if we believe, we've determined we're going to change, we're going to leave the love of the world and be determined to walk the Christian life. Repentance is willingness to change. And then confess that we believe Jesus is the Son of God. And lastly, we're told time and time again in the New Testament to be baptized for the remission of our sins. given the pattern, the example, not to sprinkle water. We see in Acts, the 8th chapter, where the Philip talked to eunuch. You know, we're not given all of that lesson he taught, but we know it included all of those steps. For when they come to water, he said, "Here's water. What doth hindereth me to be baptized?" And it specifically said they went down into the water. He was baptized and came up out of the water. So we know what is required. Just as Christ was raised from the dead the third day, when we accept Christ as our Savior, we're immersed in the watery grave of baptism. We arise a new creature, having the gift of eternal life, and becoming sons of God, that we too may inherit eternal life. False prophets all down through the centuries have ridiculed the Word of God. They made fun of it, but God's truth still shines. And as we've seen, it endures forever and ever. It'll not be changed. We find in Psalms, the 119th chapter, Psalms 119 and 104. David writes there, through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore I hate every false way. So he's saying it's through God's word, his precepts that he's given us, that he can find the truth. And he'll know a false truth. We'll know a false teacher when he hears it. Through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore I hate every false way. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. God's word lights the way of darkness. It lights the way. It shines a light for us to follow. It gives us the roadmap. It gives us the example, the commands to follow, and commands that we should not do. It's a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I have sworn and I will perform it, that I will keep thy righteous judgments. So we see here of great importance of the authority of God's word. And through our works, through our daily lives, we can put his words into action through our works and through our actions, what we say, what we do. We go back again to that commission he gave those disciples, and in Mark 16 and 15 he told them there to go into all of the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. So this charge, you know, it went to the whole world. It excluded none. God's word is to be preached to all persons, whosoever will, has an opportunity to hear and to believe that same word. This gift is offered to all. There's no hardship you have to do. You don't have to travel to a certain spot and touch a certain wall. You don't have to beg to be voted on to be accepted as a Christian. This is a gift of eternal life. We have to just obey his word. So we see here the importance of following his word, God's word, in our daily life and in our preparation for eternity. Our life here on earth is brief. Even if we live to 100, our life is brief, especially compared to the eternity of heaven forever and ever and ever. So our life should be spent in preparation. God's word is quick, it's powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder. God's word is powerful. It can save, it can change our lives. You know, we have a great sources of different power here on earth. We started out, you know, years ago with horsepower, and horses were the main mode of transportation and power, driving buggies or stagecoach. Eventually, you know, we went to the power of steam, and steam was harnessed to build a fire, heat this water, steam would drive huge locomotives, and that power, that force would carry great train loads. We've had various different sources of power. Hydroelectric power, you know, these big dams, and turn generators, and we've advanced very far in sources of power that helps our lives, enables our lives. We've got solar panels now. That's very new. You know, we're seeing big solar farms come up. It's all of these fields full of solar power that's able to light up or provide electricity for a whole city. We've got nuclear power. You know, we've got nuclear aircraft carriers in the military that are able to go out on the oceans. You know, used to have old fuel or gasoline or something. We'd have to go to a port and refuel. These huge ships have had safe nuclear energy to be out for months and months and months, never worry about filling up again. But all of this power, you know, if you could harness all of that power all down through the ages, all of that power wouldn't be strong enough to lift one soul out of hell. Think about it. Nothing we could come up with. We remember the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. You know, once they faced death, the opportunity to change, the opportunity to pay attention to God's word is over. There's no more hope. No amount of power, no amount of words or intents could change your eternal destination once you face Christ in judgment. This rich man wanted to send Lazarus, you know, for a drop of water in his torment. But no one can go back forth from that great gulf. So our preparation must be today, must be now, because our soul may be required of us at any time. So this morning we have, in closing, another opportunity to look at God's word. We have an opportunity to examine ourselves, see if we are ready face judgment. And if we're not, we have an opportunity to change that, to obey God's word. We've not accepted Christ. We can make that confession and be baptized for the remission of our sins. Or if we've taken those steps and for one reason or another, fallen back, done, said things we know we shouldn't, we've given that second law pardon. Confess those faults one to another and pray one for one that we may be healed. If there be one of any case, won't you come and make your life right with the Lord as we stand saying this invitation?
Jesus is tenderly calling thee home, calling today.
meant to mention, today was Brother Philip's day, and Philip tested positive this week, so he's sick and unable to be here. We had another gentleman from Panama City that was going to come, and something happened to him too, and ended up in Lexington, so came back to me. That's why I was here today.
Turn the service over to another brother.
Come to another important part of our worship service, that is the communion of Christ. Let us clear our minds and remember the sacrifice. Let us bless the bread. Father and God in heaven, we come to you this time asking you to bless this bread, which to us Christians represents the body of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, as we break from this bread, we pray that we'll examine ourselves in a manner that's well-pleasing unto thee. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now let us bless the cup. Father in God in heaven, we come to you at this time asking you to bless this cup that is the fruit of the vine, which to us Christians represents the blood of Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, as we drink from this cup, we just pray that we will examine ourselves in a manner that's well-pleasing unto thee. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Upon the first day of the week, we are instructed to lay by the source. Let us do so now.
Number 501 will be the last song this morning. Number 501, if you want to turn in your books and be ready to sing in just a few moments. It's been wonderful to be here, and hopefully each and every one has enjoyed the services here this morning. And as always, if you ever have questions about anything, always feel free to ask, and we'd be glad to study with anybody those things that we teach and believe here, because we believe that those things we teach and the way we worship, we can prove them, and hopefully you would consider that, and if you have questions, always feel free to ask. But remember our services here Wednesday night. Also remember the meeting at Bandy with Brother Slade Powell. Is it at 3 today?
It starts at 3, and I think it's
7:30 the rest of the week, yeah. Except for Saturday night, and it's 6 o'clock. But remember that and pray for that, and I think Walnut Grove has one starting too.
Sure.
Week after, so
week
after this week, whatever that
next Sunday.
Next Sunday, okay. So remember that and pray for those gospel meetings, and hopefully they will all be well, and they'll have a great gospel meeting. So let's remember that and remember to pray for one another. Remember our flower fund and shelter fund, and let's remember to do all that we can for the cause of Christ, and to teach others, if we can, God's word. As Dale pointed out here this morning, how powerful it is to be able to save the soul. And but once the soul is gone, you know, there is no saving. And so we need to do everything we can possibly to help those that are in need, that is spiritually in need, to bring them back to Christ if we possibly can. I think maybe some may not know, but Mickey and Sandy were united in marriage 11 days ago now. It will be 11 days ago, 9 o'clock tonight, I think, somewhere around 9 o'clock. And we're going to have a little reception after church services this morning to just to let them know how much we appreciate them, and how much we love them, and how much we care about them. Also, you know, they made confessions of fault before they were married. And because they not only wanted their marriage to be holy, they wanted their lives before God to be holy, because their marriage to the Lord meant more than their marriage to each other. And there's nothing more wonderful could be said than that they wanted their lives to be right with God. And I think it's so important and so wonderful that they wanted to do that. And It really touches my heart that they feel this way. So that was wonderful, and it was a joyous occasion. Not only their wedding with the blessings of God, but also their confessions that they wanted to be right with God. God, when we confess our sin, He won't accept our sins, but He will accept our forgiveness, as the Bible teaches. Can we continue in sin that grace abound? The Bible says, God forbid. God's not going to allow grace to abound where there is sin, but if we will turn from sin, then we can have the grace of God in our lives, and that's what they wanted, that's what they received, and the angels in heaven are rejoicing over it, and we are too, and we're going to show them that after a while. So very thankful for that, and I have a few other announcements after our service is dismissed, but if you would, we'll stand and sing number 501, the first and last verse. Give me the Bible.